Walid, now a born-again believer, has a perspective on Islam from his days as a terrorist that you'll find intriguing. Brother Hutchings, you and Walid go back a ways. Tell us about your first meeting.
Thank you, Brother Jerry. The first time I met Walid was in Dallas. I introduced myself, and you had a rather interesting remark, Walid.
Yes, I did. I remember that speech. I got up to the podium, and I addressed a few scholars that were there attending, and I asked a simple question. I said, out of all the verses in the Bible, can any name a single verse in which God destroys a country in end times context, and that country or that nation is not a Muslim country? No one could answer. In fact, then I went further and I said, when out of all the verses in the Bible where Christ is fighting a nation, and that nation is mentioned, can anyone mention a single nation that he fights in end times context that is not Muslim? No one was able to answer. And I asked, why are you not answering? And no one would answer. So I remember I asked one of the scholars there, why are you not answering? He says, well, because we cannot find any. They're all Muslim. So I said, how come you haven't written about this? Because for decades they've been writing about the Roman Empire being the European Union and such. And now we see the domino effect, Brother Noah. We see the revolution in the Middle East. We see the nations raging. Raging at Israel, at God and his son, just as the Bible predicted. And, you know, many in the West still have their heads in the sand and do not want to believe it.
Yes, but one of the remarks you made when I introduced myself, you said you listened to me when you were a terrorist.
That's correct. I was listening to you, working at the Lindbergh Company, driving back and forth during my research. It was, in fact, I was listening to very heavily, and because you have a unique voice. And that unique voice, I've just known that unique voice every time I heard it on the radio. I said, oh, that's Noah Hutchings. I better listen.
Well, that's a nice way of putting it. I appreciate it. You know, there's been a lot of controversy about what is happening in Libya, Egypt, and what's going on between Mr. Obama and the Muslim Brotherhood. You know, people are confused about what is happening. Do you have any insight to enlighten us?
Well, I've been looking at the Arabic language, and I monitor the Arabic language because I'm an Arab researcher. I don't look at what the West is doing because they seem to be blaming themselves over the movie that came out, including the president was saying it's all about the movie. Even after the attack on Libya, the American administration still refuses to accept that there is an Islamic revolution. And so now they're having to come out and say it was a terrorist attack in Libya. But it's obvious what happened. I'm monitoring the Arabic. I find that a Nur party, which is a Salafist party in Egypt, it is the other party, lesser in power than the Muslim Brotherhood, which holds the office. And they're quite open. There's no difference between the Salafist and the Muslim Brotherhood. The difference is that the Muslim Brotherhood dresses up in suits and ties and acts as they are pro-West in many ways, which they're not. But the Salafist Nur Party by Mr. Bakar had gotten together with Dar al-Hikmah, in which they wanted to start to spark a revolution. In fact, I monitored their TV interviews, and they've been saying that we failed in the United Kingdom to twist the West's arm to begin to adapt Sharia about the cartoon issues and about insulting the Prophet Muhammad, and they'd failed in Germany, and so now they wanted to twist the arm of the Americans in order to begin the ball rolling to do Sharia reinforcements in the West, and especially also in Egypt. In fact, the demonstrations in Egypt on that Friday right after 9/11 was not about the film. It was about what they call Beard Day. They wanted the officers and the military to have the right to grow their beards as Islam demands. And so the idea was to enforce Sharia in Egypt because, of course, Egypt has been under a secular government. And now since they have the Muslim Brotherhood, they want the full enforcement of Sharia, including a law called Hiraba, which is the penal code, Egyptian Muslim penal code, in which they should allow crucifixions and amputations of limbs and so on and so forth. So this is something we're going to be witnessing fairly soon in Egypt. And that's what it was all about. It had nothing to do with the film.
For those who may be listening for the first time and don't know what it is, he, of course, is from the Middle East and was once, I believe, in jail for terrorism. He came to the United States and found Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And since then, he's had a marvelous testimony and a great source of information about what is happening in the Middle East, the Muslim situation here in our country also. And he's written at least one book and doing a great, great work for the Lord now. Dr. Spargimino is with us. Dr. Spargimino, do you have a question?
Well, I wanted to make a comment about that great book that you just mentioned. It is God's War on Terror. And Walid, your comments on, I believe it's Daniel 9:26, where you speak about the people of the prince that shall come, and you point out that they were from the 10th Roman Legion, and that was staffed by Turks and Syrians. You started the program today to speak a little bit about the Roman view and the Islamic view. Tell us how all of that ties in, because I think you've done a tremendous job in God's War on Terror.
The Western view regarding end times has recently began to think of a Roman-European view. But the older view, in other words, the older scholars, have focused much on the Islamic view. In the modern view, there are two locations in the Bible in which they try to make it a European construct or a European paradigm when it comes to end times, and that is Daniel 2, the iron legs, and Daniel 9, 26, the people of the prince. Those are the two main focus of the modern Western view on a European construct or a European paradigm. However, if we look at the entire Bible, it does have Islamic nations, including nations Christ fights. In Daniel 9, 26, the people of the prince, the misunderstanding of the people of the prince is that it's talking about the hegemony of the Antichrist who is to come, that is 2,000 years later or so. So we need to understand who were the people that destroyed the temple. The hegemony of those people are the same people of the Antichrist. Legion 10 was Roman indeed, but it was construct of several nations, Edomites, Arabs, Turks, Syrians. Today, these nations would be Islamic. So this is the misunderstanding. It's the people of the prince. It's not the empire of the current prince at that time when the temple was destroyed. It's the empire of the prince who is to come 2,000 years later, and the people that destroyed the temple, those are the people of the Antichrist who is to come. And that's the misunderstanding. When it comes to Daniel 2, the older schools have always thought the construct of the iron legs is Roman, Seleucid, or Ottoman Muslim Empire. And we have basically ignored that interpretation and continued with the era of the European construct. But if you apply a European construct or a European paradigm to the end times only, by the way, that does not construct the entire Roman Empire. What about North Africa? What about Libya, Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco, Mauritania, what the Bible calls Fut? That was part of the Western Roman Empire. And by the way, those are mentioned literally in the Bible. Do we eliminate those from the construct of this Roman Empire? We can't. What about Turkey, which was the eastern leg of the Roman Empire? Turkey today is the most powerful Islamic country there is. It's the second largest army in NATO. And by the way, they are mentioned in the Bible. Even further, they are mentioned in the Bible in a battle which Christ invades that land. In Zechariah chapter 9, you know, Christ goes and fights into the north. And Ionia is crucial. Ionia is mentioned in the Bible. The text of Zechariah 9 says, I have set your sons, O Zion, against your sons, O Greece. Yavan, that is Ionia, Turkey. So it's mentioned literally by name, including Christ in the New Testament. Very clearly says that the seat of Satan is where?
Pergamos.
Pergamos, Ionia, Turkey. There you have it. So we can't eliminate this from the paradigm. It's very crucial that we focus on it. And this is why I wrote God's War on Terror, Islam, Prophecy, and the Bible.
Walid, your book, War on Terror, of course, we recommend it highly. And those of you who don't have a copy, we would encourage you to get one. And Jerry, our announcer, will tell you how to do that at the close of the program. But we see what has happened in Libya and Egypt and other parts of the Islamic world. And now we look at our own country and see mosques sprouting up all over the country. What is happening in North Africa and other parts of the Islamic world? Does that portend a reason why we should be concerned here in the United States?
Absolutely. The concern is in the United States. We have a president who has links to his family of a Muslim origin. He's very sympathetic to Islam. He had claimed to be a Christian, but I haven't seen that testimony of his conversion. Plus, you have the slick willies of the Islamist movement have created a Trojan horse. How many Americans know that the Muslim Brotherhood, in its design that was caught, it was captured during the Holy Land Fund Foundation, in which the Muslim Brotherhood declared that they will destroy the miserable House of America, as they called it, from within, that is, creating a Trojan horse, in which you have Islamic elements in the government. What about the case of Huma Abedin? What about Michelle Bachmann? Have spoken out on the issue. Only 1% of the Congress stood with her, 4 congressmen. That's it. The rest, 99%, don't want to even address the issue. You have the speech that was written by President Obama, was written by Rashad Hussein. Rashad Hussein is an Islamist. He defended Sami al-Aryan. You have the Fort Hood massacre by a Muslim. And then you had, right after the massacre, they brought from the Islamic Society of North America, Lu'ay Safi, who's an Islamist, to lecture the troops of how to become Islamic sensitive. So the West, or especially the United States, is silent about this infiltration, and dare anybody ask a question about this? So you've seen it at all levels. When it comes to the Middle East, you have the Syrian Revolution, which my son Theodore can talk about. The issue of the Middle East, in Syria, you have the SNC, they're no longer an influence in that revolution, and Syria is a key point. Yet the United States supports the Syrian Revolution. They support the Islamic Revolution in Syria. So the United States have not woken up regarding that whole Islamic Revolution, and dare anybody ask a question?
Well, our national policy at the present time regarding Egypt, for example, seems very self-defeating. You know, we give the Egyptians millions of dollars that we don't have. We have to borrow it from China, and we pay interest on the loan, and we give it to Egypt so they can burn our flag. I think you're absolutely right. We need to wake up and open our eyes.
Yes, I mean, you look at the situation in Egypt, you know, they burned the flag. They attacked a sovereign country, the United States of America. That's a sovereign country, that embassy. And, you know, Americans still are in self-blame. They blame themselves. They say, it's the movie. But I have a question that begs an answer. There was one pastor that wanted to burn a Quran, and I believe Brother Noah Hutchings, myself, and all of them are against burning the Quran because they don't believe in burning books. 99.99% of Americans refused to support the idea of burning the Quran, even the movie. So by that, I have a question. If 99.99% of Americans were against this style of critique of Islam, the Muslim world should have demonstrated that America is a great country. 99.99% of Americans refuse to burn our Quran. What a great country. They should carry a leaflet that says, God bless America. But that's not what happened. Now, assume at Egypt, one man wanted to burn our flag and the entire crowd stopped him. We would be demonstrating in the streets and say, Egypt is a great country. But that's not what happened, you see. So we have to look at the seriousness that no matter what we do, These people are against the United States of America. They want nothing but its destruction.
Right. Just by our existence, we could do absolutely nothing and they would still hate us. And of course, as you point out, we're not in favor of evangelizing by insult. But, you know, when the Da Vinci Code came out, nobody issued a fatwa on Tom Hanks, or when Lady Gaga's Judas, or Serrano's photo of Christ on a crucifix and a glass of his own urine, and the U.S. taxpayers paid $15,000 for that so-called artwork, nobody demonstrated. So what a difference between Christianity and Islam.
Well, the difference is very clear. We know our God is true. He exists. He can defend himself. We don't need to defend him physically, because a God that does not exist and that has basically used very demonic means to establish a kingdom for Lucifer on this earth needs his people to follow him and needs to apply violence in order to implement what they want. So we believe in a true living God. They believe in a God that is not true and is not living.
Yes, we look at the history of Islam and the history of Christianity, and the comparison is almost unbelievable. We know that the Byzantine churches of 500 A.D., 600 A.D., didn't Muhammad have a role in killing tens of thousands of Byzantine Christians?
He started with the Jews of Banu Qurayda, and he stated that no church, no synagogue will be allowed in his nation, and that is Saudi Arabia. However, it continued on after his death, in which Islam under Muhammad II, 1451, attacked the hub of Christendom, and that's Byzantium, and took it over. In fact, the largest mosque in the world is a church. How many Americans know that? Hagia Sophia. So the idea of building or converting churches into mosques, or building large mosques at centers where Christendom exists, is part and partial, it's a signature of the Islamic Revolution. This is why they wanted to build a mosque in the area of 9/11, to say that we were victorious, we've attacked the United States, and we were able to build a center. And a mosque in Islam is not simply a place of worship only. It is an embassy of Islam, to remain as an embassy for the revolution. So this is part of the revolution. This is why even you have Faisal Abdul Rauf, who says on TV that if Americans don't allow us to build a mosque, I am very concerned about their air traffic. That's, by the way, a threat. So you have two parts of the apparatus of the Islamic Revolution. There is the violent apparatus attacked us on 9/11, again and on 9/11, and there is the slick willies, if you will, the revolutionaries who want the same goals, but they will wear ties and suits, and they will say they're moderate, when in reality, they're wolves in sheep's clothing.
You know, when we look at all of the, what should we say, the outrage against the video, it seems that the outrage said, well, Muhammad wasn't that kind of a person. Tell us a little bit about what kind of a person was Muhammad. What about his character? And what about the video itself? Is it that off base, or is there some semblance to historical reality?
Well, Muhammad as a character, he's really the antithesis of the Lord Jesus Christ, absolutely the opposite. He denies the very elements of the sonship of Christ. He denies the deity of Christ. Yet he gives himself titles that only belong to Christ. In other words, he is an antichrist, but in the same realm, he wants to replace Christ. So he gives himself titles like Al-Maqam Al-Mahmud, the glorious one. While Muslims claim they do not worship a man as the Christians do, because they accuse us of worshiping a man named Jesus, when in reality we worship God who became Jesus. You know, so this kind of the lie about Islam. And so they declare he is Al-Maqam Al-Mahmud, the glorious one. He is Ar-Ruh Al-Amin, the trusted spirit. He has an angelic being. In other words, if you look at the description in the Bible about Lucifer, they match quite well with Muhammad, the character of Islam. He ascended to heaven, he says. Well, Isaiah 14 says, you have said in your heart, I have ascended to heaven. In fact, when I read the Bible as a Muslim, And I looked at Isaiah, I began to see very much the same elements Muhammad had claimed. And I'm sure you've heard about it. Muhammad claimed to have ascended from Jerusalem into the seventh heaven on Al-Buraq. Al-Buraq, the lightning bolt, and all these stories that are in the Quran. People need to start focusing on what Muhammad claimed. And by the way, the Mahdi of Islam, who comes to bring 7 years of peace, have the same claims. This is why he sits in the temple of God, declaring himself to be what? God. In other words, the Muslims really worship a man who tries to give himself attributes to being God, while they deny that they do worship a man. They bow towards the black stone, and they say it takes away their sin. Yet the black stone is definitely an image that fell from heaven, exactly as in Acts chapter 19, verse 35.
Yes, that's extremely interesting. But, you know, there is a switch now, I think, in study of eschatology concerning the Antichrist. I think gradually more prophetic scholars are at least considering the fact now that the Antichrist could be a Muslim. Maybe you can get into that subject more on the next program.
Right. Andrew McCarthy I forgot his name, but he's a very major teacher from California, and he is switching to the Islamic paradigm. Several are switching, including Jack Van Impe. He used to come on the TV. He's thinking about the Eastern leg currently, so it's really turning around.
Yes, well, we want to talk about that, and also, Ted, your son, has done...
Today, Walid Shoebat returns to the program, and his son, Theodore, joins he and Brother Hutchings and Dr. Larry Spargimino. Theodore's done intensive research into the name of Allah, and what you'll hear today about that is amazing, to say the least. He wrote a paper on the topic, which appeared on WorldNet Daily's website. Here now is Brother Hutchings and Walid Shoebat.
Thank you, Brother Jerry. Walid, yesterday, as the program ran out, we asked you to discuss the change in views of eschatology by many prominent prophetic scholars today, that the Antichrist could be a Muslim. Now, there is one time that I would not have even considered that. But as I consider the points that you brought out and the realities of today, I myself have come to acknowledge that the Antichrist could be a Muslim because, you know, the Muslims are in charge of the Temple Mount, and we know the Antichrist is going to sit in the temple showing himself to the world that he is God or claiming to be God. So the Islamic power also in the Middle East is growing tremendously in the past few years.
Yes, because, you see, the parts of the Bible which we cannot ignore, I mean, we could disagree that it's the European Union or it's the Islamic Empire or Islamic Empire that has been wounded that's rising back again. But the verses in the Bible, which includes all the wars Christ is fighting, he's fighting Muslim nations. What about Isaiah 19? The Lord comes riding in a swift cloud and is coming to Egypt. He's not going to Rome. He's not going to Germany. He's going to Egypt. Did I say that? No. Isaiah said that. That's very crucial. It's the word of God. God said it. God said he's himself coming to Egypt to fight in Egypt. And what's going on in Egypt? The spark of the Islamic Revolution is from Egypt. The Muslim Brotherhood is from Egypt. The persecution of the Christian Copts is in Egypt. The Copts are mentioned in the Bible. They will cry to the Lord to send them a savior, and God will send them a savior and a mighty one. Who's the mighty one? The Psalms tell us, gird your sword on your thigh, O mighty one. O brother Noah, do we not want to meet the Lord at that moment? Do we not land with him on the Mount of Olives? Does not the Mount of Olives break in two? And all the saints are with him. The saints, you and me and others, we will be with the Lord Jesus Christ landing down on the Mount of Olives. Why are we down there? Because the Islamic nations, the surrounding nations, the neighbors of Israel have went against the Lord Jesus Christ, against his people, the chosen people, Israel, And this is when the battle begins. The one-day battle, the day of the Lord that the Bible so much spoke about, includes nothing but Islamic nations.
You know, after I read those statements in God's War on Terror, your excellent book, that really opened up a lot of things to me, and I know to many others. Before we go too far into this program, we do want to talk to Theodore or Ted. So if Ted, if you could come to the phone, you know, your research shows that the oldest known references to the Islamic deity Allah are not in Arabian records, but in Babylonian artifacts. I think it's called the Epic of Atrahasis. Tell us about your research, the conclusions, and why this is so significant.
Right. Well, for years we've been hearing from Christian writers that Allah is the moon god, and that the Arabs worship the moon god. And it's true. I'm not doubting it at all. But they say, well, you know, the inscriptions connect Allah with moon worship. But the problem with these arguments, while they are true, it's difficult to have people convinced in them because there's no inscriptions which name Allah openly. They always point to inscriptions which refer to the moon god Sin or Su'en of Mesopotamia. And it's not Allah, it's Sin. So why should we believe it? So it's difficult to convince people in it because it doesn't name Allah. So I've always been looking for some sort of an open inscription. And so after looking into it, I found out that some of our oldest inscriptions, which refer to Allah openly, only go back to around the 5th century B.C., which is around 401 years to 500 years before Christ. And these are only found in South Arabia. And so it's old, but it's not that old. So one day I was reading a book called Myths of Mesopotamia, and it's a compilation of multiple text tablets that were translated into English, and one of them was called the Epic of Atrahasis. And I read through it, and it's just the flood myth, and how one man, it's like Noah's Ark, one man built a boat to save humanity. And the man who saves humanity from the flood, his name is Atrahasis. Well, the beginning of the epic begins with how the gods were working and laboring for a deity by the name of Enlil. And they got sick and tired of their work, and they had a revolution, and they revolted against Enlil. And so because their gods revolted, they didn't want to work anymore, Enlil made man to be slaves to the gods. And the god who began this revolt or this revolution, his name was Allah. And it's spelled A-L-L-A. And I've always wondered if maybe the translator or any other Assyriologist caught up to this. And none of them did. Thorkild Jacobson, Stephanie Dolly, Andrew George, these are all major scholars on Assyriology and translators who know very well a lot about the Epic of Atrahasis, and they comment on it or write on it extensively, but they never connected Allah with the Arabian deity. And so if you would like, I would read to you what it says.
Yes, that's very significant. Go ahead.
It says, then Allah made his voice heard and spoke to the gods, his brothers. Come, let us carry Enlil, the counselor of the gods, the warrior, from his dwelling. Now cry battle, let us mix fight with battle. The gods listened to his speech, set fire to their tools, put aside their spades for fire, their loads for the fire god, they flared up. And I was wondering, the person who translated this, her name is Stephanie Dolly. I checked and I read through Stephanie Dolly's dictionary. She has a small dictionary of Sumerian and Mesopotamian gods and terms. She never once mentioned Allah, not once. And I was wondering, what's Stephanie Dolly's opinion on the Bible? Well, in her introduction to Atrahasis, she criticizes the book of Genesis, saying that we don't believe in the book of Genesis anymore, and there's no proof of it, there's no proof of Genesis, and the Hebrew book of Genesis is filled with uncertainties and et cetera, et cetera. And then she actually wrote an essay on the biblical God Yahweh. So I read through some parts, and she actually says that Yahweh is an indigenous pagan deity of Syria. So what is her evidence? Certain inscriptions that mention a man by the name of Azriyahu, who was a pagan in Syria, supposedly a pagan in Syria. And she says, Yahu sounds like Yahweh, so it must be referring to Yahweh, and therefore Yahweh is an indigenous deity of pagan Syria. Wait a second, that is your evidence? So you're telling me that you found an inscription that just mentions Yahu, and you automatically assume that's Yahweh because it sounds similar, but yet you find an inscription, Allah, in the Mesopotamian tablets, and you make not even a speculation that this could be connected with the Arabian god.
Now, this Allah in this Babylonian epic, he is a deity of violence, isn't that correct?
Yes, the deity of revolution and violence. He revolts against the gods. But people say, well, Ted, how could you quickly connect this Allah with the Islamic one? Well, I'll tell you why. Because the person who wrote the book of At-Tirhasi, the Epic of At-Tirhasi, his name was Api Ayya. Api Ayya was not a Sumerian. He was an Akkadian. Who were the Akkadians? The Akkadians were, in fact, not originally Mesopotamians. They were natives of Arabia who migrated very long ago to Mesopotamia. And they brought Arabian deities with them. They brought the goddess Alat, which is the feminine root of Allah. So my question is, if they brought the feminine Alat to Mesopotamia, that means they must have brought Allah with them, because Allah is the masculine form or masculine root of Alat.
This is all very significant, because I think it has something to do, or certainly it would seem to affect the Islamic doctrine of the Quran being uncreated and perfect in every way. And I've got a copy of the Atlantic magazine going back to 1999. It has an article by Toby Lester, and he talks about the great mosque in Sana'a, Yemen, and so on and so forth. If you were a devout Muslim, would this kind of shake your faith in the belief of the Quran being word for word perfect, and that Islam is, you know, from heaven?
Well, it would disprove one thing in the Quran, and that is that Allah was at one point in time purely worshipped as a non-pagan deity. There's a verse in the Quran in chapter 3, verse 67. It says, Abraham was neither a Jew nor a Christian, but he was one inclining toward truth, a Muslim submitting to Allah, and he was not of the polytheists. Well, there is no, for one thing, there is no ancient inscription which refers to Allah as being worshipped monotheistic, as a monotheistic god, or being worshipped purely. It's always connected with some sort of idolatry or pagan creed or belief. So the oldest reference we have here is the Epic of At-Tirhasi. This goes back, some people date it to 1700 BC. Some people date it as far back as 1800 BC. And again, Allah is being worshipped as a deity, or referred to as a deity, alongside other gods as a pagan deity. So there is no evidence at all of Allah ever being worshipped purely. There is evidence of Yahweh being worshipped purely, and there is evidence of Yahweh being worshipped idolatrously, as an idolatrous deity. And that, of course, is admitted in the scriptures. So it's a no-brainer. People say, well, Ted, Allah was... We have archaeological dates, you know, archaeological relics of pagan idols found in Israel. So this proves that Yahweh was worshipped amongst other deities. Well, excuse me, it's in the Bible. The Hebrews built the golden calf and worshipped Yahweh at the same time. It's in Exodus. Or the Hebrews worshipped Ashtoreth and Yahweh at the same time. It's in the Bible. It's a no-brainer to us. And it's simply admitting that, yes, our people did sin in ancient times, but they were wrong.
Yes, if I may interject.
Yes, go ahead,
Ali. With Nimrod and Akkad, Theodore, I think Nimrod is also mentioned as Antichrist in Micah 5. Micah 5 talks about the birth of the Messiah in Bethlehem, Ephrata. Then we will have peace when the Messiah comes to defeat this Assyrian, who is the Antichrist. And then it really equates him to Nimrod. And you have stated, Theodore, that Nimrod and Akkad are connected. Can you maybe expound on that?
Yes. Well, here's something that a lot of people miss. They say, well, Babylon is the mother of all false religions. And that's partially true, but it's not the whole story. If you look at Genesis, it says, and then came Nimrod. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord, and the beginning of his kingdom was Erech, Babel, Akkad. What's Akkad doing there? The Akkadians, like I said a little bit earlier, were originally South Arabs. They came from South Arabia. So if Nimrud, who was the founder of Babylon, who was the instigator of the Tower of Babel, built the city of Akkad, that means they were Akkadians at the time of Nimrod in Mesopotamia already. And if you look at what I have read in the archaeological evidence and the annals that I have looked into, the Akkadians brought with them certain deities. Like I said, Alat, they brought Shemesh, the sun god. They brought Aftar, which is the god of Venus in Arabia. They brought all these several deities with them. So that means at the time of Nimrud, these deities were being worshipped, apparently, because if Nimrod built the city of Akkad, they were apparently Akkadians there. And not only that, but if you look at scripture, it says Nimrod, the son of Cush. Well, if you look at the scripture, it's not just referring to genealogy. He was the son of Cush, no doubt, but it's also giving you a geographic story of Nimrod coming from Ethiopia, the Cushites coming from Ethiopia into South Arabia, Sabaean, Seba, these are all South Arab people. And then from South Arabia, it goes to Nimrud. Nimrud went to Mesopotamia. So it gives you the migration from Ethiopia to South Arabia to Mesopotamia. Well, the Akkadians came from South Arabia into Mesopotamia. So apparently what happened is when the Cushites entered Mesopotamia, the Akkadians were there with them alongside, hence why the son of Cush, Nimrud, builds the city of Akkad. So these Akkadian deities, these South Arab deities, were there in Mesopotamia at the time of the Tower of Babel.
Let's not forget, all the references in the Bible regarding Babylonia, Babylon included Arabia in ancient times, and all the references in the Bible about the future Babylon, it mentions the names of the cities, the regions. Babylon in the Bible includes Duma. Duma is in Arabia, not in Iraq. Isaiah 21 talks about Babylon being destroyed. You know, it's very clear in Isaiah 21, it says the burden against Arabia, yet it gives the same reference in Revelation. Babylon is fallen. And that's in Revelation 18 and Revelation 14. Well, both references in Revelation, if you look at Babylon is fallen, is regarding a region in Arabia, not ancient Iraq.
And I know when you read the scripture, Revelation 17 speaks about a city in the wilderness, but wilderness there, I believe in the Greek New Testament, is Eremon, and that means what? Desert.
Desert.
Yes.
It's in a desert, in the middle of nowhere. It's exactly what Mecca is. It's in the middle of nowhere. And then he took me to the desert. There he showed me a woman riding on a scarlet beast. Ah, it's in a desert. It cannot be Rome. It has to be Arabia because Isaiah 21 says it is. It talks about the burden against the what? Desert of the sea.
Well, this is fascinating. There's one more question I've got to ask, and I'm going to turn it back to Noah. But here's the question. You know, we see two confusing trends in the U.S. On the one hand, there's a growing openness to homosexuality, same-sex marriage, the legitimizing of that lifestyle. But on the other hand, there's an openness regarding Islam. Now, isn't Islam and the gay lifestyle, I mean, do they get along? Does Islam allow that kind of thing? Or will the Muslims, if the Muslims get in charge and take over, what will they do with the gays?
Well, the gays are persecuted under the Islamic law. But, however, Islam talks about pedophilia. Islam permits pedophilia. Even in the heaven of Islam, there are boys, ghilmanun mukhalladun. You can have sex with boys and so on and so forth. So it is a very mixed message that Islam gives. Islam, in fact, never condemns rape in the Quran. Why? Because Muhammad condoned rape. That women captives who are not Muslim can be raped by Muslim soldiers. And so it's a very mixed message because it's demonic. You know. So Islam is not really from God. It's impossible to be from God. It's the antithesis of everything in the Bible. Theodore, would you like to add anything else?
I would also like to add that Islam is not a conservative religion. Many people make it out that it's a conservative religion, it's family-oriented, believes in conservative values. But if you look into it, Islam, the whole purpose of Islam is to unite the whole world as one. It's a one-world order, if you will. And it's very similar to the leftist idea of collectivism, in which everybody is united together. That is why the left today, they're pushing for merging our national law with international law. They want to make America not sovereign, but a part of a universal community. And in Islam, it's no different. It's the Ummah, the Arab, the Islamic community of Muslims, all united together under one law, the Quran, under one religion, Islam, under one language, Arabic. Same thing with what was going on in the Tower of Babel. One language, one ideology, all united together.
So once again, the New World Order is not so much European or Roman, but it really fits into an Islamic eschatology and what we're seeing now, the universal worldwide Islamic caliphate, if you will.
That is correct. And this is why we have to focus on the Bible. We can't go beyond what is written in this book. Usually prophecy is mystery to us in the beginning, but as it gets fulfilled, it becomes more clearer. And this is why Daniel the prophet says the book is sealed for the end times. The closer we get to the end, that kind of knowledge will increase because God will begin to unveil for us what has been veiled in the past. So as the unveiling becomes clear to us, we as believers need to kind of work it together and put jot upon jot, tittle upon tittle, a line here and a line there. In other words, we have to become Bereans on the Word of God. The Word of God is a blessing, but it's also a curse. It's a blessing if we allow God to read to us what He said. And it's a curse if we read into the Bible what God has never said. That's been the problem in the West. We look into the Bible and on a paradigm, and we try to read into it what it doesn't say.
I would like to ask a question. I'm not sure that you would have the answer to it. But our president seems to observe Muslim holidays and occasions and events more than he does Christian holidays and personalities and events. There are some who say that he is more Muslim than Christian. What do you say?
Well, that's a very interesting question, Brother Noah, because the spirit of Antichrist, number one, denies the Father and the Son. President Obama said the most favorite sound he's ever heard was the call to the prayer. In classical Arabic language, he recited the call to the prayer in classical Arabic. Allah is great, Allah is great, there is no messenger, and Muhammad is his messenger. That's the call to the prayer. Now, having said that, the idea of changing these festivities is very crucial from a biblical sense, because Antichrist, or the spirit of Antichrist as well, just like the Antichrist, as Daniel the prophet told us, he will attempt to change set times and set laws. Hello? What is going on? Why are the Muslims demonstrating in 30 different countries? They want to change our constitution. They want to change Western constitution. They say, Al-Qur'anu dusturuna, the Qur'an is our constitution. They want to change the laws. They attempt to change the laws. And also the times, the festivities that God had ordained on earth for the Christians, they also want to change. They want to now have Eid. They have Iftar. They have Ramadan in the White House. So this all is part of the Antichrist movement. People need to start to think that changing the times and the laws is not changing the cosmos, as people think. Antichrist cannot change the cosmos. God runs the cosmos. It is about the festivities and the biblical festivities that God had ordained. They want to change all these things, including the time. Do we have Anno Domini, the year of our Lord? That's how we set our time. The Muslims say, no, it's the year of their Lord Muhammad, the Hijra year. That's the date that they want to enforce over the Anno Domini.
There's been a lot of tremendous, interesting information you both have discussed on the last two programs. We appreciate both of you being with us on the broadcast the last 2 days, and it's going to be interesting to see how things develop, as you both have indicated, in the future. So we live in perilous times, the Bible tells us, and we look for the coming of the Lord at any time. So we certainly appreciate both of you being with us. Now here there is Brother Jerry to tell our audience how they may obtain the books that you've written. God bless you both, and may the Lord increase your testimony concerning the times in which we live.
And may the Lord increase your longevity, Brother Noah.
He'll be 90, what, December the 11th, I think. He'll be 90 years young.
We need him alive.
Amen.
Yeah, I'm still 89. I still work 6 days a week. I go to the gym every night and work out for an hour and still play golf. So the Lord has been good.
Indeed he is.
Walid Shoebat's hardback book, God's War on Terror, presents a view of the end of the age that some have held before, but most Bible students have not. It's worthy of your inspection, so call, write, or go online today for your copy of the 514-page book. It's offered in appreciation of your $35 contribution if you live in the United States, $40 for those of you in Canada. Call us at 1-800-652-1144. write to Southwest Radio Ministries, P.O. Box 100, Bethany, Oklahoma, 73008. The website address is swrc.com. In the explosive book, Walid puts the pieces of the prophecy puzzle together. Be sure to contact us right away for your copy of the hardback. Programs in this series are also available on a CD. Get it for an offering of $14 in the U.S., $15 in Canada. Number to call, 1-800-652-1144. Coming next over most of these stations is today's Bible in the News report. Tune in Monday for your Watchman on the Wall program of Southwest Radio Ministries.